I want to bring in epidemiologist Dr. John Brownstein now for more on the latest COVID-19 updates. Dr. Brownstein, good morning. You know, we keep talking about the warnings against travel for Thanksgiving, but as we heard in Gio's piece, people say they want to live their lives. We hear that planes have good air circulation, passengers usually have to wear masks. So why is it so risky?
Yeah. So good morning, Diane. You know, truthfully, we should be avoiding all travel, right? Travel in any scenario comes with some risk to yourself, to your family, to your community. Planes alone maybe are not the most risky things to be on, but it's all the sort of activities around the edges, right? The airports, the transportation to the airport, the jet bridges, all of those sort of combine to increase risk. And those places are ones that you can't stay 6 feet apart. And the plane itself is not zero risk, right? And this is why we recommend sitting in a window. Hopefully there's no one in the middle seat. But overall, we know that increased mobility drives increasing cases. And we see this every time after a holiday that we see this spike in cases after a major sort of holiday event where there's travel. And this is the most travelers we've seen yet. And I just do want to make a point about testing, because I know we see these images of people getting tested in airports and getting rapid tests. They do not mean that you are not infected. It reduces the likelihood you're infected, but you could easily be asymptomatic and get a false negative test. It means that you're carrying this virus and you're bringing it home to your family and bringing it across this country. So again, travel by plane or any mode is going to be super risky this Thanksgiving.
We've also heard several political leaders point to small gatherings with family and friends as a major source for the recent surge in cases. But now a new report of the New York Times says data doesn't support that. What are the facts here?
Yeah, this is a really tricky one because, you know, we know that small gatherings, actually, you know, small events with friends outside your household is a major source of spread, and there's great data to support it, but overall, it's tough to prove, right? It's hard to pick up these events through contact tracing. Survey data is hard because it's hard to trace back who you were in contact with. It's easier to spot major super spreading events like in prisons or nursing homes, but these are probably not what is driving community spread. It doesn't mean that the states and federal government are off the hook. I mean, we've had poor communication from the beginning. People are trying to parse all the risks that they have in their daily lives. So we really can't be shaming people into doing the right thing. I always say putting the public back in public health. How do we get people to engage in reducing risky behaviors and bring this transmission down? And so it's all about working with the public and not shaming them into sort of submission, which has been really the problem for many months now.
And thousands are lining up to get COVID tested before Thanksgiving. Now Quest Diagnostics is reminding people to only get tested if they're asymptomatic or rather if they are symptomatic or they're exposed to someone with the virus. But we've heard officials say before that asymptomatic testing is key to tracking. So how do you square that?
Yeah, this is really a tough one to sort of come to understand because demand is soaring right now, right? We're seeing more people getting tested than ever before, like 1.5 million tests a day, so highest all time. But the problem is states are dealing with the sort of the weight of all this testing, long lines, challenges in terms of getting test results back. And if you know, if you get a test result back in 3 to 4 days, it's basically useless. So with limited resources, we're going to focus on symptomatic individuals, but that leaves out a huge segment of the population. So when you have test positivity that's really high, it actually means we're missing a lot of people. And so the CDC acknowledges actually that most transmission is happening from an asymptomatic perspective. So again, the testing is not enough to get this virus under control. We need to be using testing more than a clinical diagnosis, but really as a surveillance tool. And that's really the challenge that we're facing today.
In the meantime, more reason to be extra careful with the other precautions. Dr. Brownstein, we appreciate your time. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, everyone. George Stephanopoulos here. Thanks for checking out the ABC News YouTube channel. If you'd like to get more videos, show highlights, and watch live event coverage, click on the right over here to subscribe to our channel. And don't forget to download the ABC News app for breaking news alerts. Thanks for watching.